Welcome to the Catalyst Sale Podcast with Mike and Mike. Sales is a thinking process. This podcast will help you learn about what works in sales, how to hone your skills, and increase your success. I'm your host, Jody Mayberry, and I'm pleased to say we've got another listener question, Mike and Mike.
Thanks, Jody.
Yes, I know you enjoy these. This one comes from Laura in San Francisco. Laura says, I am reorganizing our sales team. What should I include and what should I avoid in a comp plan?
At its base, from my perspective, when I think of comp plans, I think of comp plans as a math problem. And the challenge with that is it becomes a lot about ones and zeros. But at its base, math problem, first start with on-target earning. You know, what range are we looking at for the role that we have inside the organization? Once we've established that on-target earning, then we've got to figure out what are a couple of the variables that go in there. One of those variables would be base salary. Are we heavily focused? Are we heavily slanted toward activities that are not necessarily revenue generating in that role? And does that warrant a higher base? Or is there a significant amount of value put toward the revenue that's generated in that individual role? And do we have more flexibility in making the plan heavier, more slanted toward variable?
Yeah. Well, and Jody, I have to apologize because we had another question from Rob that I forgot to tell you about yesterday. But ironically, it's similar, but I think we'll address it in the discussion today. And his question was about how do I set up my comp plan? I'm expanding from just having account executives, and now I'm adding account managers who have a completely different job than the people that prospect for new business. How do I make sure that I address the comp model so that it rewards both positions? Do I pay double commission? All those things. So I think in today's, you know, discussion, we can kind of weave that in too, because what you'll find is that though it is a math problem and it really does boil down to, you know, making a plan that makes sense both for you as a company and achieving your financial objectives, but it's also got to work for your employees. If you want to have salespeople and retain them, you want to come up with a plan that's fair, equitable, generally gives people an upside so that you're rewarding the right incentives and the right behaviors to grow your business. But then it also, there's some realities that kind of drive the culture and how your people sort of work together. And you can either support that and build a collaborative team, or you can very inadvertently create a lot of tension between different groups inside of an organization. And that's all just because of how you model your comp plan. It drives a lot of behavior.
So what's an example of where you would create tension?
Okay, so you think of a lot of examples, but yeah, I'm kind of keeping with, I think what Rob was getting at was this idea that for everybody to be happy, I would essentially have to pay double commission. Once my account executive sells the deal, because they did so much hard work in the beginning, that once I hand it off to the account manager, if that account grows or an additional sale happens during the year, I should pay both the account executive for his hard work and pay the account manager for managing the account. And so essentially walking into a double commission strategy. And though that's a way to make everybody happy and a way to potentially compensate a team, what you end up doing is you're rewarding basically somebody just because, you know, they happen to have their name on a deal when it came in the door. And if the account executive had nothing to do with the growth in that account, why would you compensate a salesperson for essentially not, you know, adding value? And so in that scenario, what I would do is I would look at, and this is what we do with our own organization, is that we understand the fact that people will put a lot of work, account executives will put a lot of work into creating new business and new deals. And oftentimes what happens is it's not that first deal that's the big deal. In other words, you've solved a problem, you have sort of that first engagement, and it may not be the larger project that you're working on. And to the extent that there's still growth to be had, that's something that the account executive knows is part of their strategic plan. So in that case, I would have the account executive continue to work on the larger opportunity. But after the first transaction's made, if the account executive can't create an opportunity in Salesforce and tell me that there's a strategic sales plan and that he knows that this is the opportunity that's coming up in 2017, I would say basically all he's trying to do is mark his territory so that he can be paid next year. And the idea would be, if you know there's an opportunity, create the opportunity. You can continue to work on it as new business. But when accounts come in the door, remember that the thing that ultimately will drive growth, particularly in a recurring revenue business, new business at first is what drives your growth. But over time, it's retention and it's growth inside of that base that really drives how much your new business engine needs to deliver in order to continue to grow. Because the larger the base gets, the larger the churn gets, the less growth you have inside that base. It puts more and more requirements on the new business side of things to keep your company in a growth mode. So really getting all three of those areas optimized between your team members is what drives your growth. You have to have a solid account management strategy, a retention strategy. You have to identify opportunity inside of those accounts. And that's your account manager or the person that's what they're in charge of doing. And will they benefit from the great work that the AE did in the beginning? Absolutely. But at the same time, what you want that person, the account executive, doing is focusing on getting more of those new clients into the system. So it gets pretty complex, but at the end of the day, it's just about making sure that it's equitable for both of those roles.
So getting back to Laura's question, and you think about reorganization. And when I think of reorganization, I think about, you know, how can you reorganization for the purpose of creating focus inside the company to put customers with the right rep at the right time. So I've got this combination, and you know, traditionally you think of account executives in more of a hunting role. You think of account managers in more of a farming role. I don't really like those two distinctions, but going with them a little bit further, if I know that I've got an account manager who is picking up an account from an account executive and they're not going to see that next sales activity, that next revenue generating activity until the point of a renewal, the way that I address that is I put a heavier level of priority on the account manager's base. The base is what's compensating them for the work that they're doing, both in taking on that account, transitioning the account, working through the implementation. Then they get the variable component on any sales that they generate next year. But their comp plan may be more heavily slanted toward a stable base and a lower percentage in the variable. There's some other things that you want to consider too. And I think Mike hit on these, but how long is the sales cycle? So, and how long does it take to get a customer to the point where they plateau in their revenue stream into the organization? So in a traditional model, you know, or you know, a lot of the one that's getting a lot of excitement right now is the whole land and expand. So we get that initial deal in place. It might be a 20K deal or a 100K deal or a 200K deal, but the larger enterprise opportunity is $1.5 million or $2 million. Well, the account executive may want to take on the day-to-day account management of that account as they grow it over the 6, 9, 12, 18, 24 months that it takes to get it to a seven-figure deal. But from the perspective of the organization, you may want it in the hands of an account manager because they're better suited to do that work. And in that instance, they're actually hunting and growing inside an account. So I'll bring that back together and just say, I think it's really important to understand, what does the role entail? How does the business work? How do customers buy? And what does that life cycle look like for an organization? At what point do they move to revenue plateauing and you know, more consistency in the base versus high growth?
Now, I may be stepping away from the question and what you want to talk, and you can bump me back if you need to, but I'm curious, does a comp plan impact the culture of a sales team?
Absolutely. It's amazing, actually. I can think of an organization that we've worked with that basically didn't have a comp plan, or they had a comp plan, but it was basically just a salary. And they thought it would be a very good idea to incorporate a variable commission plan into the culture because they thought that would incent salespeople to want to sell more. And on paper, that on the surface, it makes a lot of sense, right? If I can make more money because now I all of a sudden get commission, that would be a great thing. Great for the company, great for the sales rep. Everybody's happy, kumbaya. Well, the problem that you can run into is that the competitive nature, and not just the competitive nature, if it's just bragging rights, you might have a team that has, they're competitive by nature and it's just, hey, I want to be able to say I'm number one on my team. And that's all great. But when you introduce money into the equation and you start talking about, well, now the number one person traded their car in and they're driving a new car, or they're making more money than I'm making now because they're making more commission dollars. That's when things that used to be maybe no big deal because we were all working for the good of the organization becomes, how is it impacting me? And I saw that happen where even with a group that I was actually surprised to see the degree to which this happened, all of a sudden it went from looking at the success of the overall team and saying, wow, we're doing great, to how is it going to affect me? And very quickly, the other thing you run into is, and this is kind of a, we are going to be a little random today, and I apologize for that, but you also deal with this issue, which is an entitlement issue. And so once, this is the hardest thing, when I think of poor Laura trying to change her comp plan and she's in a reorganization and things happen, sometimes you have to reset expectations. Sometimes you have issues that you're going to have to deal with. Like, I've worked with that account for several years. I own that account and I should get to keep it. At the end of the day, that's not the case. We have to realize as salespeople that we manage a set of accounts or a set of opportunities. The customer belongs to the company, and the company has to do what's right for not just you as an individual, but for the whole ecosystem that you work in, which includes your customer, which includes your peers, your management, everybody. And there'll be times when you'll feel like, my gosh, I spent all this time working on this account. Now, all of a sudden, it's being taken away from me. And usually in a reorg sort of scenario, it's impacting everybody. And you try and do it in a, hopefully Laura's doing this in a non-disruptive way as much as possible. I mean, you don't want to just turn all of your account base upside down and move a bunch of things, but there'll be things that really bum people out. But you have to be able to make sure that what's communicated is that it's equitable, that we're giving everybody a fair opportunity to seek the financial rewards tied to their goals and what they're motivated to do, and that nobody's really intentionally being advantaged. It's just what the business needs. So a lot of it's communication. It's bigger picture thinking, not just about the individual, but here's what we're really trying to do as a company. And here's how that then affects you as an individual, but this is how it affects your team as well.
And from a sales leadership or just general leadership perspective, you should be able to, you know, back away and say, I understand this is the letter of the law in the comp plan, but there are some adjustments that I can make that make sense for the business or make sense for this individual opportunity. So we talk about sales as a thinking process. Leadership should also be a thinking process. We should be able to apply some thought to those unique scenarios that not every comp plan is going to be able to address. And really what this gets back to is trust. Do you trust the leadership inside your organization? If you're trying to make changes without that trust, you're going to have a difficult time. And we all know it takes a lot of time to build up trust, and trust can be lost quickly.
This question that we've been addressing is from a higher level, somebody that's developing a comp plan. I want to bring this all the way down to the individual level. If I'm a sales professional and I'm considering opportunities, how do I know if a comp plan will work for me?
So when I think of this from a sales rep perspective, I start to think about first, what is the compensation plan modeled after? I'd like to understand how the top performers are doing inside the organization, what the percentage of sales reps who are meeting plan inside that organization, what are the percentage of sales reps who are exceeding plan inside that organization? What do I know about why those sales reps are exceeding plan or making plan? So I start to get an understanding of, from a sales rep perspective, how can I break the comp plan? If I can break the comp plan, then maybe there's something that the organization hasn't thought of. And I want to make sure.
So you're the guy that games the.
It's not about gaming it. It's about breaking it. It's about saying, am I going to be compensated for the behavior? Am I going to get properly compensated for the things that make a difference inside of the organization? Am I going to be properly compensated for my time? Is this thing achievable? I mean, I've been in scenarios where interviewing for different roles where someone puts out this great comp plan. And when you go back and you do the math, you find out that the year over year growth for that specific territory is about 200%. And there's nothing in the background based on all of the conversations we've had before that lead you to believe that 200% growth is an attainable number. That would be a comp plan that looks good on paper, but doesn't actually look good when it comes to fair compensation for the role. So that's what comes to mind when I think of it from an individual perspective.
Yeah, and I think that's something to keep in mind when you're both looking at new opportunities, because unfortunately, what you'll get is, well, this is what my top rep is making. And that top rep may have been there for 5 years, may have had a really nice account base. Who knows? The question I usually ask if they don't talk about that, when we get into the questions and we start talking about compensation, and I've looked at their comp plan, one of the things I'll ask is, you know, where do your top 10%, where does the top 10% fall in this plan? What's the achievability, attainability? And Mike was talking about this a little bit. But a year over year thing too, as an employee, I also look at how is the company adjusting the plan as you go? Because as a company goes through its life cycle, that plan might evolve, and it has to evolve to meet both the needs of the company and your personal needs. And so as a individual contributor, as a sales rep, I would always want to see how is the company adjusting as we grow. I understand that it's not just going to be this linear thing that's going to make me a millionaire year over year if I stick around, but are they being fair? And that's really, as a sales rep, that's all I really ask for, is that the plan is fair, that it rewards performance. So I'm always looking for things that reward top performers, because that's the bucket I want to achieve to be in. And then I also look for instances where the comp plan changes frequently. If I was a sales rep and I worked for a company that has an annual comp plan, but I find that, you know, in August, they make adjustments to the comp plan because the company projections aren't where they thought they should be. If I'm on plan and I'm operating to the level that I thought I should be, or whatever the case might be, my point is, frequent changes in your comp plan can become very frustrating, because you're planning your year, you're planning your activity, you're trying to do the job that they've asked you to do based on the comp plan. And if it's a moving target, it becomes extremely frustrating for people. So even as a business owner, as a sales leader, even if the plan, if conditions changed in my business and I see that the plan could be optimized, even if it's at a disadvantage to the company, as long as it's not going to sink us, but we have to take a little bit on the chin. I'll take a little bit on the chin before I'll go back to my sales team and say, hey guys, guess what? We're going to call an audible in August, and the rest of the year, this is what your plan looks like. Nothing would defeat a team more than making that kind of change with 3 or 4 months left in the year. I would wait until the first of the year when, if that's when your normal changes to your commission plan and things like that occur, try and put it in the normal cycle and not introduce change halfway through the game.
Yeah, and that brings up just a number of the misses that you see in comp plan development. The other frustrating thing, both from a rep perspective, from a sales management perspective, from a general leadership perspective, is when you miss on your comp plan date. So yeah, I've been in organizations where comp plan is supposed to be available or supposed to be out there by the 1st of January. It's a new sales year, new comp plan that should be communicated. And come March, and we're still working off of the old comp plan. So now not only have you closed business so far in that year, that's probably compensated off a previous comp plan that maybe reset your accelerators, but that comp plan factors in things that you may have in your pipeline, which starts to drive negative sales rep behavior. They start to sandbag and not include as much in their pipeline, at the risk that next year in March, their comp plan is going to be adjusted. So that consistency is so important. And that is a great way to lose trust inside your organization, is when you start messing around with comp plans mid-year, or you deliver a comp plan late. So, you know, just like you want to do with your customers, set expectations, meet those expectations. If you're going to miss those expectations, clearly communicate and reset those expectations, but don't feel like you've got to, don't get yourself into that scenario where you've got to go back to the well multiple times and change things up like Mike's talking about.
Yeah, I can tell you from experience that delivering, so in my past life, we would have an annual sales meeting, and it was always the first week of January or 8 days into the month, whatever it was that worked on the calendar and for travel. I can tell you that the tone of that meeting was different when the comp plan wasn't delivered at that meeting and on time. And when we made that as a leadership team, I made sure that that was always completed for the sales meeting. Comp plans printed, ready to execute, ready to roll out and describe at the sales kickoff meeting. That made a tremendous difference about how everybody received the kickoff meeting. They knew where they stood. They knew what their goals were. And I can't think of anything that's more important than that. People need to know what your expectations are, how important it is both to you and to them. And if you just tell them, well, you know, we'll have it, we're working on it, it's being reviewed by finance and we'll get back to you in 60 days, you might as well not even have a sales kickoff meeting. It's just, I think it's that important.
Well, this has been great information. Thank you so much, Laura, for sending in this question. If you have a question you would like Mike and Mike to answer, just send an email to hello@catalystsale.com, and I will bring it live on the show here, and Mike and Mike can answer it. They not only do they delight in answering questions, they're a little easier on me when the question comes from you rather than me. So send in your questions, or you can find us on catalystsale.com or at catalystsale on Twitter. Thank you again, Mike and Mike, for a great episode, and thank you for listening to the Catalyst Sale Podcast.